Hi, I'm Prasanth Thakre. So in this video, I'm covering the basic and more in-depth details about the famous managed web service by the AWS that is known as the Rout 53. So I have observed like that more than 7 to 10 questions are coming directly or indirectly into the AWS Solution Architect set exam. So it is important to have the good knowledge of Rout 53. So I'm trying to cover all the policies and details about the Rout 53, which is going to be very helpful for you when you are appearing the exams. So let's jump on the more details about the Rout 53. So there are the multiple questions like what exactly is the Rout 53, why it is named like the Rout 53, and why I need it, and other questions like does it replace the load balancer, or you can say like that does it really care about the traffic balancing, and what about that registering the domain, is it possible to do it by the Rout 53 or not. So let's try to understand that is it like it is working as a registered domain, or why it is named as a Rout 53. So I'm going to the next slide. So Rout 53 only return the rule evaluated IP address. It never connect user to that IP address. So basically when user is trying to access your domain, for an example like xyz.com. So in this conditions, Rout 53 is only providing the IP address, which is the relevant, and it is based on that some rule based algorithm. And then again, with the help of this IP address, user is going to connect to the xyz.com. It's not like that Rout 53 is directly connecting to that web server. So this is the first things which is required to know. And there are the other details like the name is referenced to the TCP or UDP port 53. So TCP and UDP default port is the 53. And that is the reason it is known as the Rout 53, because 53 protocol is used by the TCP and route is kind of a routing. Where DNS server requested our address. So basically it is required for us to know about the DNS as well to understand the features of Rout 53. Second is that Rout 53 is also enables AWS customer to route users to non-AWS infrastructure and to monitor the health of their application. So please note it down like it's route the user to non-AWS infrastructure, and as well as it having the capabilities to monitor the health of their application and its endpoints. So yes, Rout 53 also monitor the health of the application and as well as its endpoint, and also Rout 53 is capable to connect the non-AWS infrastructure as well, just not only the AWS structure, AWS services. Rout 53 is completely managed DNS service from the Amazon Web Service, and it can be seamlessly connect to the ELBs, EC2 instance, CloudFront, S3 bucket, and yes, whatever is the outside to the AWS, which I just included into the third point. And it does the health check. So it is required to know that yes, health check is also being done by the Rout 53 because it can continuously check the heartbeats of applications by sending the automated request through the internet. It answers the DNS query because it returns the IP address, and the low latency is basically based on your rule based algorithm, which I will cover into the other slides. So yes, it is providing the latency based routing and register the domain names as well. So AWS is like a resort where you can register the domain names and you can configure the policies, and it is the managed service, so you no need to involve into the much on that managing like services down or up. It is also providing the good scalability and availabilities. So here is the diagrammatic view, like this is the Rout 53, and here I mentioned like that it seamlessly connect to the EC2 instances, CloudFront, and I have included the CloudFront in other videos, so you can just go through the other videos as well to know more about the CloudFront. And here you can see that we are having ELB and Rout 53 provide the seamless connectivity with the ELB as well as the S3. So first, it is required for us to understand the domain name basics. So you already know that .com, .net, .org, we generally append into the websites. So this is managed by the top level domain. This is known as a top level domain, where the example.com means like example is your domain name, like xyz.com or yahoo.com or gmail.com, and it is known as a naked domain. And if I am appending the www.example, then it is become, this complete is called as a subdomain or the fully qualified name, fully qualified domain name. And if you are having server on server1.us, ist like prefix you are adding in your naked domain, then it is called as, it is also known as a fully qualified domain or subdomain. So this is the fully qualified domain, api.aws.amazon.com, where API is known as the host, and .com already I updated here that it is called TLD, top level domain. And yes, the dot is like root, and aws.amazon.com is subdomain, and this is the complete domain name. If you are having any confusion, you can just update in the comments. I will try to answer it. So this is the another diagram, and this is the complete diagram, which is good to know that how the user is interacting with the xyz.com and what is going behind the picture. So this is the first thing, is like that when the user types into the browser xyz.com, then this request first goes to the ISP IP resolving host. This is the main host, which is managed by the main service provider, and here it provide that what is the IP address of xyz.com. but if it is the first time user is calling the xyz and it is not cached here, in that condition it will go to the second workflow, that is called the root DNS. Root DNS doesn't know anything about the xyz.com. Just it know that, okay, I know the .com, from where I know about that .com, in which xyz.com I don't know anything about that, but I know from where you can get the IP address. So basically it gives the IP address of those servers which are holding the IP address of xyz.com. so it will give the IP address of .com. if suppose xyz.org is there, then it will give the IP address of DNS server which are having IP address of the relevant website. So here you can see like that we are asking for the .com, so it will return the IP address of server which are holding that website which are ending with the .com. So it will go to the TLD DNS, and here I updated the TLD servers holding the top level domain IP addresses. So it will go directly here, and it will say like that, okay, I know that what is the IP address. I don't know about that what is the IP address of xyz.com, but I know that there is the authorized domain, and I can give you the IP address of authorized domain name service, and it will give you the exact IP address of xyz.com. So this TLD DNS containing the all website are registered, and it is against that the authorized domain name service. Then in the next flow, it will go to that authorized domain naming services, and it will give the exact IP address, and this resolving host will resolve the IP address. Resolving the IP address, it means whatever the IP address is given by that authorized domain name server, it will give it to the user, and then user will seamlessly connect to that web server, app server, or any website. Here it will directly connect to that web server. So here you can see that xyz.com having the IP address 10.192.123.21, and then it is directly requesting or connecting to this web server. So one more thing here, like that this resolving host, when it is getting the IP address, then it also sent like that TDL, time to leave information, which helps to cache it. If user is again asking that I want to go into the xyz.com, then this resolving host is not going with this all workflow, but it will give it back the IP address, which is the cache. So yes, it is required to know that resolving host is capable to cache, and it will cache for the particular time, which is defined by the time to leave, and TTL will be provided by the NS server. So that's all about that, how the DNS work and search the IP addresses. And this is the example for xyz.com. So here the important thing is like that, you need to know that more about that TTL, caching mechanism of the resolving host, as well as authorized domain naming service having the connectivity with this web server, so it knows that what exact is the IP address, and it has all the domain records. We will go to the next slide. So DNS record type, this is very, very important, and almost all the time whenever you are appearing in the exams, at least one or two will come in the exam. So these are the left hand sides are the record types. So a record type is basically nothing but record name to the IP address. So like for an example, you are having xyz.com, then what is the IP address? NS is the IP of the name server. So here you can see that this is the NS server here. So NS is the IP of name server. And CNAME is the alias, like one domain address pointing to the another domain, that is the canonical, like xyz to www.xyz.com, or it could be anything else. So that is the alias you are creating, and CNAME is useful to know about that. MX is generally used for the mail exchange related information, and that is the IP of email address, or you can say like that servers, email server kind of things. SOA is start of authority record indicating who is authorized DNS, one of the name server authorized domain name. So SOA is generally used for that authorization purpose, like okay, this DNS is authorized or not, who is the authorized DNS basically, and it will contain the name server of the authorized domain name. TXT is the additional domain information or the validation, so you can pass the information in by using the TXT record type, and it is just for that passing the additional information about your domain, like it is the educational purpose or entertaining purpose, or it can be also used for the verification purpose or additionally the record keeping. I'm not covering more detail about the TXT, but just it is required to know that like it is using for passing the additional information, that is enough for the exam. And we are having the four times A, it is specific to the IPv6 address for the given host. So here you can say like that we are having the single A. So this is the IPv4, but when we are talking about the IPv6, then we are going to use the record type four times A. And sorry, this is the repeated again, which I have already covered here. PTR is the is opposed to the forward DNS resolution, like opposite to the A. It is like PTR record used to look up the domain names based on the IP address. So so A and AAA is the DNS record. Four times A is basically for that IPv6. So when I'm going with the opposed to forward DNS resolution, then I'm going to use the PTR. PTR is useful for A and four times A. For both, you can use the PTR. So it will look up the domain names based on the IP address. SPF is Sender Policy Framework. It's an email validation standard that is designed to prevent the email spoofing. And domain owners use the SPF to tell email provider which servers are allowed to send email from their domain. SRV is Record Type Domain Name Systems that is used to identify the server that hosts specific services. Each of servers is assigned to a priority and weight, which allows to use the DNS SRV for the failover, load balancing, or the both. So the basic knowledge of this record type is good enough for appearing in the exam and passing the exams if the questions are coming related to the Route 53. So one more thing here, I'm just trying to say like that Route 53 having a capability to provide to reduce the latency, basically it can help you to provide the regional based redirecting. Like here you can see that Singapore user is going to log in with the help of xyz.com. So Route 53 knows like that, okay, which IP address I need to pass to the Singapore user. So for an example here, your application or web application is deployed into the multiple region. So here I have taken the two example. One is for two regions. So one is like Singapore region and another one is the North Virginia. So we are having two user. One is coming from Singapore user. So Route 53 will give the IP address of Singapore region like that, and Route 53 will give the North Virginia region IP address, so that there will be less latency and Singapore user will not face any performance issues with the website. So this is the use of one of the basic use of the Route 53. But just remember like that, here the user is requesting for the xyz.com, Route 53 is just returning the IP address. It is not connecting to the web server. Web server is here, but it is not connecting. It is just giving the IP address, and here with the help of IP address, user is directly connecting to the region. Web services which is deployed into the Singapore region. So there are the main six policies of Route 53. Simple, latency, weighted, geolocation, failover, and geoproximity. So almost all kind of calculations related to that, increasing the performance and reducing the latency, you can achieve by using one of them, or you can also use a combination of these routing policies. It's not like that you can just have the one routing policy at a time. You can have the multiple combinations. You can make simple with latency, or you can have the weighted with geolocation. So multiple combination you can do, so that you can design in such a way like that user will not face any latency problem. So first I am covering here is the simple Route 53 policies. So here it is default kind of Route 53 policies, where user is calling for the xyz.com and Route 53 is giving the IP address to the user, and user is directly connecting to the web server. So there is nothing much to learn into the simple routing policies, and it's like a default kind of policies where Route 53 is just providing the IP address without checking the region or location or something like that. Next is the latency. So for an example, you are having your service is deployed into the three different region, and here you want to give a solution like user should not face the latency problem. So here you can see that user is getting the response in 70 milliseconds, but here when if I'm giving IP address of North Virginia to user, then it is taking hardly 20 milliseconds. But if Route 53 is returning the IP address of North California, then it is taking double of it. So to reduce the latency and increase the performance, it is advised to use the IP address of North Virginia. So latency based routing you can configure, latency based policy you can configure into the Route 53, and Route 53 will always return the IP address of web server which is providing the response in compared to the other response time. It will provide that the less latency time IP addresses. So basically here you can see that Route 53 is knowing that okay, North Virginia IP address will be suitable for this user because it is returning the response in 20 milliseconds. And Route 53 having configuration, and you can just do that latency based configuration into the AWS, and user will get the IP address without knowing anything, which is having the less latency. So this is the weighted routing policies. The weighted routing policy is very, very useful. When one web server is having more traffic and one web server having less traffic, or it could be possible that you are having the higher infrastructure and you want to redirect the user to those servers or those web servers where you know that okay, here I am having that high infrastructure and there will not be any performance problem. So it's pre-calculated, where you are calculating and you are providing these policies that if user is coming, then I will send 40% user to the North Virginia, 30 to Singapore, and 30 to North Carolina. Or you can also, if you are having a very good infrastructure into the North Virginia, you can also go with like 60%, and you can divide the user like 30% here and remaining 20% here. Sorry, 10% here. You can redirect to the user. So this is the one example where there could be multiple use cases, but many use cases like that. You are sure like that you want to redirect more and more user into particular region, then it is very helpful, and you can just configure the pre-calculated ratio, and you can also change it later on. This is the geolocation, and in geolocation, like your services are deployed into the multiple different geographic location, and you want to make sure that if there is a ASEAN user, then you want to redirect to the Asia region, and if it is like EU user, then it redirect to that Europe region, and if it is a user region, then redirect to the US region based web server. So for an example like YouTube, if you are logging from the India, then you are getting more and more suggested pages which is related to that based on that Indian region. And if you are in Europe, then it is providing that suggested pages to the Europe region. So this is the one example, because it is fulfilling that user request in such a way like that you are providing that interest based on that particular geolocation. Like for an example, the politics user is logging to the YouTube, and it is providing that latest information and news update. It is providing from the India related news information it is providing to that user. So this is the very good policies when you want to redirect to the user based on his location. This is the failover. So failover is basically like your service is deployed into that multiple region, or you are having the multiple means to provide that response. But for an example, something is down, then how you are going to handle it? So here I have taken the one example where your service is running into the Singapore region, and it is not running into the other region, and there is a fault like website is down. So immediately Route 53 will redirect to that other IP address, and this service is running like for an example, just I have taken as S3, but it could be possible that your service is running into the another region, and just you want to show that error content. So this is very helpful that user will know that website is down, there is error content, or it is gone for maintenance. So you have seen that there are the many website when they are down because of maintenance. At that time you are getting a page where it is showing that okay, it is down because of maintenance, and it will be up after 30 minutes or something like that. The last policy is like geoproximity map. So here the user is into the this region, and there are the multiple services are running into the another geolocation. If suppose you know that this is near to you, but it is into the different geolocation, so you can route the user based on the distance calculation between the user and the web server. So whatever is the less distance, that IP address will be redirected by the Route 53 to the user. So the bias distance is being calculated by the Route 53 by using this formula, where it is the actual distance multiplied by 1 minus bias divided by the 100. So you are having the multiple bias here, but the actual distance is this one, and here you can see that actual distance is very less compared to the others. So rather than redirecting to the same geolocation, user is being redirected to this location. So this is all from my side related to the Route 53, and this only from these six policies you will get question from the in the AWS solution architect exam. And one more thing you need to remember about the DNS record type, and that is more than enough. This is just for the basic, like how DNS work. It is not required to know that what is the ISP, root DNS, TLD, authorized, NS. This is not required to know. Only thing is like that this record type figure, we generally use this record type. This is very, very good to know, and it is very, very important, and make a note of it when you are going to the exam. And this 6 routing policies is required to know, and this is not difficult to remember where it is being used. Just having this pictorial view is more than enough. Like here you can see that, okay, the latency is hardly 20 milliseconds when the user is being connected to North Virginia. And here you can say like that, okay, I'm predefined, and my infrastructure is very good into the North Virginia region, and I will not face any kind of performance, and you are having good auto scalability, so you can redirect more and more user into the weighted by using the weighted policies. In the geolocation, is simply name itself is saying that, like that, where the user you are deciding that what is the geolocation of user and providing the IP address of that web server which is deployed into that geolocation. This is the failover. It is just providing that, okay, what is the error coming into the website. If suppose your website is down and you want to send the predefined error content to the user, then it is very, very useful. And last one is the geoproximity. Doesn't matter where user is located, but you are providing the IP address of that user, which is that bias distance is very less. So this is all from my side. Thanks a lot. And please, if you are having any question, update into the comment section. Thank you.